Good morning. We're so grateful that you have chosen to worship with us today. We are excited and thrilled about what the Holy Spirit is going to do in this service as we prepare to gather together in prayer. Let's invite the Holy Spirit into this place that we are in together today. And just so thrilled to see and to hear the testimonies of what God is going to accomplish today. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. And we are just so honored to have your Holy Spirit with us. We are excited to gather, to continually connect in every platform that we can so that we can continue to be the church. We are just so excited for what you are going to do, what you are going to speak, what you are going to declare. Our hearts are opened and we are listening intently. Father, bless this service from the worship to the word. And we just give you the honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And when I'm feeling like I've been let down by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me. In the eye of the storm, when my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I picture slowly fade away. And when the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds. And I just don't know how I'm gonna make ends meet. I did my best, now I'm scared to death that we might lose everything. And when a sickness takes my child away and there's nothing I can do, my only hope is to trust you. I trust you, Lord. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me. In the eye of the storm.
God, I to stand. Oh, a God I hold in the palm of my hand. I have a God that's holding me, yeah. And I don't have a God that I can create in the place I live with the money I make. I have a God, He made everything. So I don't need a temporary man-made deity when I got the real thing. I got the real thing. He's the Lord of all the earth, the maker of all things. He alone is the one true God. Kingdoms rise and fall, but even through it all, He remains the one true God. Yeah.
I want to encourage you this morning to worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings, with your giving today. And we want you to be faithful with your giving as you always have been. As you know, there are many ways you can give. You can text online giving. Of course, you can even mail your checks to the church at 3600 Manhattan Boulevard, Harvey, Louisiana, 70058. But we want to encourage you to be faithful to the Lord. We know that God is faithful to us. The Word of God says if we sow sparingly, we reap sparingly. But if we sow bountifully, we reap bountifully. So let's be diligent today. Let's sow into the kingdom of God. Let's be a blessing to the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for blessing us today with all that we have. We know that you're the giver of every good gift. And so we thank you for our everyday provisions. And Lord, we ask you to bless this offering. We ask you to bless the giver. That we thank you for rebuking the devourer from our homes, and we ask you for health, wealth, and wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Shake the I'm going to be teaching today a message called Eyes for Us. And I want to quickly say thank you to all of you all over, those of you in Siberia and Russia and the United States, all the people that are watching this during this particular time. I am waiting on a word from the Lord where we're going to have our service pretty soon, where we're going to invite all of our people to come in, and we'll do what they say. We'll be 6 feet apart. Our sanctuary and the balcony can afford a lot of people. And so I'm hopeful, but I'm waiting on a word from the Lord, and we're going to go ahead and invite people. And I don't think it's very long. I want to talk today about a continuation over the last 3 Sundays dealing with discerning a prophetic word from God, but also tapping in purposely under the anointing you have as a spirit-filled person, the person of the Holy Spirit living in you, the prophetic word of God himself that always points back to Jesus Christ and gives him glory. I'm going to read some of my notes here. I can't wait to get back to preaching where I can jump around and I can go up and down and I can move around, and we have people literally pulling the anointing out me. Other than that, I have to just stand here, which is uncharacteristic to me, and read my notes. But the major message of this particular teaching is going to be the importance of developing what I call, I don't know if anybody else does it, and as a matter of fact, I'm thinking about writing a booklet for ministers called Unconscious Obedience, where so many times during the day when I hear ministers that ask me for leadership, if they would practice unconscious obedience, in other words, purposely, instead of thinking for themselves, sitting down in their office or getting with someone else and talking things over, like you talk about the Saints football game or about hunting or fishing or something like that, but get out of that thinking about the things of God in the natural mind. But that's my term for prophetic directive. In other words, the prophetic is about what God's going to do, but that's important. But what's really important to us personally is the prophetic directive tells us what we should do to prepare it or give it an opportunity to manifest. And most people don't. It's just like you're going to the grocery store. You write a list of things you already imagine that you want and you need. Well, it's not that way in the prophetic. The prophetic is finding out what God wants to do, what God wants you to do. And so that's not our normal living. So you might have been saved for a long time, but how much of the prophetic word do you really have in your life leading you to be spirit-led? You're spirit-filled. That's automatic. But now there's a discipline to become spirit-led, and you do that by the Spirit telling you what he wants you to do so that he can reward that with a prophetic manifestation, and too few of our people do that. So I wrote in my notes that it could be a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, or a simple spirit leading. And I practice this all the time. Where you, and it's nothing wrong with falling and missing it. It's better to miss God trying to follow his leader than thinking for yourself. Lean not to your own understanding. And so once you have the word, and the people who listen to me over the years know that when I get a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom, I've trained myself to act on it immediately so that I do not defile it in my mind. Because we look at our circumstances, or we look how we want something to turn out. And when God prophetically speaks to us, if it doesn't look like what we want to happen, or if it doesn't look like it could happen, we dismiss it, and again, we think for ourselves, and we do what seems right at the immediate thing, and we never really get anywhere. A good scripture for that is Philippians 4:6-7 through in this time. Be worried about nothing. Now, even that sounds incredulous. You know, how can we not be worried about anything? But God says, fear not. Don't even fear sudden terror. That's how far we are from the spirit life. Be anxious about nothing, but in everything by prayer and continuous appeal with thanksgiving. Now, number one, we don't pray all the time. Number two, we don't make constant appeals for God to show me your way, speak to my heart, And we're not really thankful. As a matter of fact, we're critical. We murmur a lot. But he said, let your request be made known to God. And this is the part. And the peace of God, which overrules your frustrated, worried mind, it surpasses all understanding, and it will guard and put in like a governor. It will govern your heart and your mind so that you don't walk in the flesh and so easily do whatever you say, whatever you feel like, and go do whatever seems right at the moment, always missing God's best. And in a worldwide time of uncertainty, what's wrong with what's going on in the world and in our lives right now is we don't know. You know, we know when football season is over. We know when hunting season is over. We know when the school year is over. But right now, we have no idea when this is going to be open. And that's what causes people to be shaky. And so we have to walk and live in the Spirit to know how to prepare to do what God wants us to do. I don't believe God caused this crisis, but I guarantee you he's taking advantage of it. He's going to take something that's not good and he's going to make it good. And we already know, we already have people watching us on a Sunday morning who never came to this church. And for years and years, their family witnessed to them and they wouldn't pay any attention. Now God's getting people's attention. But I'm not holding him responsible for a virus. So God's not willing that any should perish. So I don't think he's about killing a bunch of people. And he's already died to pay for sin. He's doing everything he can to bring the lost to him, and we're expecting many people to get saved. I got a scripture for you, and then I'm going to have Associate Minister Brother Wayne come up here, and he's going to prophesy towards you. Galatians 5:25 says, since we are spirits living in the Spirit, let us follow the Holy Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. And what I want Wayne to do is to lead you and tell you that God is going to guide you to stir up the anointing of the gift of prophecy that lives within you that is dormant so that you will be able to manifest your spiritual potential instead of worried about a crisis.
You are perfect for your purpose, full of potential. Yes, perfect for your purpose, full of potential. When you were born again, a spirit being. Gifts were given to you. Gifts to be used to hand out to somebody else. And all of us are now focusing on ourselves. And when we focus on ourselves, we can't focus on other people. Therefore, our gifts cannot be used. So I'm going to pray a prayer right now that there's a stirring in your gift, that you will understand your purpose, that you will begin to minister and reach out and help and love other people, minister to other people, and be strengthened yourself. When Paul would pray for the Ephesians, he prayed for spirit in the inner man. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I say to the potential that's in my brothers and sisters, the Tims, the Marks, the Marianne's, the Ellens, I speak potential stirring a fire in your life, a change in your life, that you'll begin to see your purposes and that you'll begin to use it. Yes, use it. Even this night, God, I believe, Holy Spirit, that you'll speak to them and they'll know the outreach they need to move to, the gifting prophetically what they're supposed to do, insight for the family. We stir it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Talk about obeying prophetic words, because it doesn't do any good if the Holy Spirit speaks to you, but then you don't act upon it. 2 Chronicles 20:20, believe in the Lord your God and you shall be established. When we got saved, when we believed the completion of the cross, he put us on a solid rock. He established us and he promised he'd never leave us nor forsake us. He would be with us always. But now we have to do something that's not natural. It's to believe a prophetic word about something happening that seems impossible circumstantially in our natural mind, because the natural mind cannot discern it. But if you can believe the prophet, if you can believe a prophetic word, now that's one thing to believe someone that you believe is an anointed prophet. It's another thing to receive an anointed prophecy from you. Okay, now understand, we are anointed. The same anointing that was on Jesus is on us. We have delegated authority, and we have the Holy Spirit who activates the person of Jesus Christ in our life. So we have to decide that our spirit is going to agree with that, so we can literally prophesy to ourselves and prophesy to our future in agreement with God's will and word. It is very necessary to discern the prophetic voice of God during times and seasons of this unusual radical change. Now, what we're doing right now is we're teaching on how to prophetically navigate radical change in an uncertain season. That's where we all are. That's why people are watching, tuning in, they're reading their Bible. They're trying to find the mind of God right now, because this is an uncertain season. And they find themselves out of their habit. Now they got really time to hear their own thoughts. And now that they don't know what's going to happen. They don't know if they're going to get sick and they're going to die. They don't know if they're going to bankrupt. But for you that are believers, it's the prophetic mind of God that will navigate you through this uncertain time to be walking in the Spirit, literally coming into your potential as never before. 1 Chronicles 12:32. We talked about them before, the sons of Issachar, who had understanding of the times and seasons. It wouldn't do them any good to understand the times and seasons if they didn't know what Israel was to do. Now, so it doesn't do any good for God to tell you about something He's going to do if you don't know what you're supposed to do. How can you hear, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant," if you didn't know what it was you're going to do? And what would we do? We all go back to do what seems right to us in the moment to reduce our stress. And so we imagine an outcome and we get to it. And we find out it's less than the banquet table that God wants to give us. And He doesn't get any glory out of it, because He was not the author of that thing. So to navigate change is spiritually strategic. God is specific in our life. We're general. We just want to get by. God wants you to get to it. And we just naturally are reacting in fear. But a word of God insulates you from running with the crowd. We're going to have a decree in a minute saying, why are you so emotionally upset when God said, don't be anxious for anything? Who are you listening to? Are you listening to the world? Are you listening to the worried? Or really, are you having a prophetic word? That'll take that fear out of you. Why? Because if we know God is with us, we can go through the very, very edge of darkness. So we have to be aware that many church people ignorantly, I didn't say stupid, ignorantly. Stupid is when you don't know and you don't realize you don't know. Ignorant is you just don't know. And you don't know how to find out information. But many people go to churches where these people that believe the Holy Spirit has ceased to work. They don't believe in speaking in tongues. They don't believe in prophecy anymore. They don't believe God speaks to us. So if you're a believer right now watching Mike, and I tell you you need a prophetic word, but if you don't believe that the Holy Spirit can speak to you, you're going to miss it. You're going to miss out on what God wants to do. You're going to miss out on your walk with God. And even if you heard, as the scripture says, I heard a voice behind me say, no, this is the way. If you don't think that God speaks to you, you're just going to keep doing what seems right. And many people out there are in churches where there is no prophetic voice. It's just a good teaching about Jesus and the Jews' traditions. But so without vigilance, without awareness, without personally trying to have the Holy Spirit, Mike and Elaine ask God to bless and block every decision we have. We take out insurance. This is what we believe you're saying, but you can put a no behind it. You can close the door or you can open the door. And we're going to be glad that you're leading us, whatever it is. But if you do not search after spiritual guidance, you cut yourself off from the possibilities. 1 Corinthians 12:28, And God has appointed those in church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, and after that, miracles. God has not stopped talking to the church, and God has not stopped talking to you. You might not be listening. You might not be aware he's talking to you, but he's still moving on it, and miracles follow the prophetic. So we cannot be perfected without the fivefold ministry anointing moving upon us, and some manifestations cannot happen without a prophetic word from someone in authority that speaks it over you. That's why I have my associate ministers speaking these words. So successfully walking in the Spirit is impossible without personally hearing the Holy Spirit's directives. And God uses the prophetic to overcome the limitations of our reasonable and logical mind. Brother Joshua, I want you to come on right now, and I want you to make a decree over the people that they don't miss out on anything.
You need a prophetic blessing over your life right now. And that's exactly what God is doing. This teaching is going to release a prophetic blessing over your life in Jesus' name. If you procrastinate in the day of destiny, opportunity is going to pass you by. Right now in Jesus' name, I break off every lie over your life, every stronghold. I pull it down in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, give them wisdom to turn off the news, Father. Give them wisdom to use the measure of faith that you have blessed them with to activate this prophetic blessing so that they can see the manifestation of your truth happen in their life. And some of you will say, well, I don't see it. The word says, who hopes for what they do not see? But when we hope for what we don't see, we wait for it eagerly with perseverance. Now, those of you who would receive this blessing and this word, you will go from a life of striving to thriving. Open your hearts today to receive this blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Wherever you're listening, I want you to say, God's still speaking, and God's still speaking to me. There's an interesting story in 1 Samuel 3. Little Samuel is sleeping in his bed, and the prophet is in another room, Eli. And God speaks to him and says, Samuel, Samuel. And the little boy jumps up, and he runs in, and he goes, Eli, what do you want? He said, man, I didn't talk to you. Go back to bed. And the little boy goes back, and God says, Samuel, Samuel. Samuel jumps up and runs back to Eli, and he says, what do you want? He says, I didn't talk to you. And the third time, he says, listen, this is God. And let me read the scripture. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be. If the Lord calls you, you must say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So Samuel went back and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood and called as he did the other times, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel answered, speak, for your servant hears. Then the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do something in Israel in which both the ears of everyone who hears it will shudder. I'm believing that God is going to do something in our nation. God is about to do something in our nation that every ear, believers and unbelievers, are going to know it was God. Come on, Holy Ghost. Come on, Coach. The devil is a liar. Now, think of Eli. He was a high priest. He was a prophet. And it's one thing to know that God is speaking to Samuel, speaking to someone. But it's another thing to realize he's speaking to Samuel, but he ain't talking to me. You don't want to find yourself in a place where God is speaking to other people and he's not speaking to you. Lord, I ask you, God, that you would awaken us with a hope, a desire, an unusual desire to hear the voice of God and say, I'm tired of doing what seems right to me. I'm tired of doing what other people do. I want the Holy Ghost to spiritually lead me in Jesus' name. Now, we know God still speaks in ways. Matter of fact, you know, it's hard on some of us to know that God even says out of the mouth of babes. Sometimes our children can say something that it's God speaking to us because we're not paying attention to Him. There are specific, sometimes knowing, and sometimes there are recurrent words. It could be sometimes in 1 week, five different people told you the same thing. You need to pay attention to God still speaks. He just wants you. And sometimes He speaks through closed doors over and over again, or He speaks to blessings and circumstances. So be aware. And when you get up in the morning, say, good morning, Lord, instead of good Lord, it's morning, and start grumbling all day. But you want, and I'm trying to create a desire that you would understand you have the real Holy Ghost, not a cousin Holy Ghost, the same Holy Ghost that raised Jesus, the counselor, the revealer of the truth of Jesus Christ living in you. Certainly, He wants to speak to you. We have to have ears to hear. In Acts 1:7, Jesus said to His disciples, it is not for you to know times and seasons which the Father has put in His own authority. Now the Lord is saying there are specific times and seasons that are sovereign. There are set times that God has set, and it's sovereign. We have nothing to do with that. But the book of Ecclesiastes tells us there's times and seasons to everything in our life's experience. So if you're going to walk in the prophetic, you're going to have an awareness to discern times and seasons so that you know what to say, when to say it, in what season, and how to say it, and what to do. So we are not responsible to discern everything, but we are responsible to discern the times and the seasons that are directly related to our personal purposes and divine assignments. Somebody else's time and season is none of your business. You need to know when it's time for you to act and when to speak and what to do to manifest your promise. So we must be discerning to understand what to do. And I tell pastors this all the time, without imagining a specific outcome you want, because God will back off and let you move towards that outcome, but you're going to find out it's another dead end that doesn't satisfy. And it's only going to be a natural outcome because you're moving. We teach at this church, Ephesians 3:20, that God wants to do exceedingly abundantly greater than you can imagine. So don't waste your prayer life and your action and your energy and your anointing on something that's less than God wants to give you. Now to do that, I teach, when I'm working with ministers, I teach them some basic principles. And most of them are flexible, but I've been doing it the last couple of Sundays. One of them is some things are available and or can happen at all times and any seasons. That's just general stuff. Now again, when you get specific with God, there's specific seasons and specific times that God moves, like the troubling of the water. You could sit there all day long, but until the angel troubled the word. The word there is not really trouble, it's agitate. And whenever God does anything, there's an agitation. That's why we know that God's going to be doing something in this period, because everybody's agitated right now. So it's not real trouble, it's agitated. There's something odd and unusual happening. But some things are available and happen sometimes in some seasons, and some things happen sometime, but they don't happen another time. When you read the examples of the miracles Jesus did, He did specific miracles, but those specific miracles never happened again, or He never did it the same way. So if you're going to move in the prophetic, you can't go back to what we remember that we experienced or something the way it happened, because we go back to habitual and go back to traditional, and the traditions of men make the prophetic word of God of no effect. So be careful that you're not reaching back in your memory and superposing that in what God wants you to do in the future. Just because you did it like that last time doesn't mean you're going to do it this time. Matter of fact, I doubt that you will. And then some things are available or happen only in their season. And so now we know God might want to do something in your life, and he might want you to do something, but that prophetic word is going to make you aware of a specific season, because if you act in the wrong season, you won't manifest the promise. And some things happen at set times, like the rapture, like the birth of Christ. These things are set in the mind of God, and it's going to happen when God decides, and we have no input on that. But for us, we're dealing with times and seasons so we can navigate our walk in the Spirit during this season of uncertain times. So I want to talk about prophetic understanding adapters, for example. Now, Elaine has a curling iron. That curling iron has an adapter on it. When you plug it into that current, all that power is coming out of that. But there's an adapter because you would electrocute yourself and burn yourself up if all the power came through on the output of that curling iron. So God has adapters because we're still in the flesh. All right? So when God wants to show you something, he can't give you the whole power. When he said to his disciples, there's more I want to tell you, but I'm going to blow your eardrums out if I tell you. You know, you won't be able to stand yourself if I told you pure truth. So God allows it to be dumbed down, so to speak, because we're still in the flesh. So for us to understand, he started off when there were no computers and no way to write things down and no newspapers and no publishing books. And one form that he used to speak was called the oral or the spoken form, because God's revelation was not written. It was spoken and retold to generations to generations. And it was specific individuals who had the gift of a scribe who rehearsed over and over again the same story in the same detail. So it was always told by different people, but the exact same truth was passed down over the time for people to generation to know where they came from, who they are, where they are, why they are, and where they're going. So the prophetic always wants to anchor you on how far God has brought you, where you used to be, where you are, and now what he wants you to do to where he wants to take you. Now, God said, for ask and you will receive. And he said to seek and you will find. So I'm asking all our people during this time, I want you to ask and seek for the spiritual truth as you read your Bible, as you hear from heaven, as you listen to a message, as you study the scriptures, that you are going to... This is what I do when I read the Bible as I'm writing a message. I'm already asking God to reveal the truth that's behind that printed page. So I want to know the precept that is behind what anybody else who's alive, not saved, could read the same verse, but he would never find the truth that I see. People read the Bible and say, man, I didn't get anything out of that. That's because they're reading the Word. God wants you to see the truth that he's literally hiding from the people who reject him. But you can't just pick up the Bible and read the Bible. You have to ask the Holy Spirit, the revealer of truth, to show you as you read with the intellect, your spirit will get a rhema, the revelation. That's one of the great gifts that he's allowed me to have. Now, you don't want to take the bait of the obvious, because understand, you're recognizing it out of your experience, out of your education, out of even your preference. I want you to ignore the obvious that is written, because everybody sees the obvious, but they don't go looking for the hidden treasure. So another thing God used is metaphor, allegory, and symbolism in order for the Word of God to transcend the fact that, you know, I'm out of the 60s, and it's hard for me now to be in the 2020s with the. But God said, I have to preserve this Word that's going to be the same truth to every generation. So God would use metaphor, allegory, symbolism, because some people in Africa, some people that live in a shotgun house, some pygmy in Africa, some Eskimo somewhere, no matter where they were, all basically we understand concepts. For example, I wrote, we understand sheep following the good shepherd. God, very easily, there's shepherds all over the world. We understand mountaintop experiences and valleys, dry places, desert experiences. Those kind of things, we understand light and dark. And so a lot of times, the Holy Spirit is going to speak to you in a word. Sometimes he's going to speak to you through the written word of God. Sometimes he's going to use metaphor, allegory, or symbolism. But if you have to have your spirit open, not your mind, your spirit open to be able to understand the prophetic word that he has given you. And what I like to talk about more than anything are the times and seasons. Sometimes don't have a season. I'm going to tell you about that. Sometimes are seasons, and some seasons do not need a specific time. And if we look at Psalm 31:1, I will bless the Lord at all times. Now, the scripture uses the word, I will bless the word all times, meaning God doesn't need a season or a specific time to bless him, because I can bless the Lord at all times. Now, that word times right there is really the word kairos, which means appointed time, an opportune moment, or a spiritually due season when something's going to happen, kairos. It doesn't have minutes and hours. It's not on the calendar. And this particular says, if I want to praise the Lord, I can do it in due season. It's a perfect time to do it. I can do it at all times. Now, Kronos is where we all live. I told everybody here, be here at 6:30 so I can videotape this. I didn't say whenever your fancy is, you know, get here when you want to get it. It's a specific time. And so we all see things according to minutes and hours and seconds and so on. But when you're in the Spirit, God doesn't say 9 o'clock, 5:45, usually. I mean, I guess he can do it, but that's not usually how it happens. It's a kairos season. Kairos really means the time that God is going to do something. And so we have to be like the sons of Issachar. We discern the season that we're in, or the season that's coming, that God's going to move. Because remember, even God speaks to you. If you do not have emotional desperation and desire for it, where you're able to reach out there and believe it, even if it seems impossible, then without that belief, it remains impossible. If we can believe a prophetic word, whatever it is. So Isaiah 43:19 says, behold, I do a new thing. Now, if you're not prepared for it, or if you imagine the new thing God was going to do without God giving you a specific word, if he does it, you won't recognize it, because you're looking at it through the natural, and the natural cannot discern the things of the Spirit. So the importance of the prophetic being activated is not only in understanding what God is about to do, that's all God. And in my life, usually he doesn't say what he's going to do, he just tells me what to do. So my deal is obedience to a prophetic word that I have no possibility of rationally understanding. I just have to put myself in anticipation that he's going to do it. So supernatural manifestation is dependent on, number one, fervent expectation. Just like I know God's got to move. I want him to move. I need him to move. I'm to the point in the natural, he better move. But I know the faithfulness of God. I'm not finished yet. There's a lot of things that are going to happen. So I have great anticipation. And I'm going to tell you, God moves by divine expectation. But like what I do is I have to expect God to speak, then discern it is God, not my mind, not something somebody else said. And then I got to capture it, because remember, the prophetic has to be caught, not taught. I can't teach you. You got to catch it. And then you got to isolate it from your mind and your life's experiences and all of the, in your imagination. And then you have to be expressing the fact. Now, I did this in the fact when I was in the hospital. You've heard my testimony multiple times when God gave me a prophetic word. One time it was they came in and gave me a bad diagnosis, and I said, I will live and not die, and I will testify the greatness of my God. And you're reading a satanic script. Thank you very much, but I'm not going to receive it. Now, without that, I'd have been overwhelmed by fear or self-pity, or I'd have let that curse of that diagnosis come into me. But God had prepared me, and it was my highest level of peace during that time. Now, I want Mark, why don't you come up here? And this is one of my favorite scriptures, and I want to read it to you, and then he is going to decree to you on divine expectation. Isaiah 61, and I say this to myself every time I'm about to go down. Anybody know out there know what it's like to go down? I lost my red light, by the way. And when you're going down, well, I jump up and I say to myself, Isaiah 61, arise, shine, for your light has come upon me, and the glory of God has risen upon me. Now, in the scripture it says, arise, shine, your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has come upon you, but I need that to be on me. Now, when I begin to do that, I've already emotionally and mentally and positioned myself for divine expectation that there's a word coming somewhere. So out there, if you're busted, disgusted, broke, worried, Mark is going to decree that divine supernatural expectation is going to come upon you.
Yes. So I decree and declare that divine expectation, that's the word. That's the word from the prophet. I decree and declare divine expectation into you now. God is doing a new thing, and you have to recognize it, and we have to reach for it, and we have to expect, because we don't receive anything from the Lord unless we expect. And that's the divine expectation, that he's expecting us to expect something from him. Right now, you got a word from the prophet, and he has spoken, and we have to expect to receive what he's, the new thing that God is doing in us, that God is doing through this whole thing. So that's the word today, divine expectation, and I'm believing and declaring and decreeing that he's doing a new thing in you, and you're gonna come to a new level in God with this divine expectation, and you're gonna grab something that you've never seen before in Jesus' name. Amen.
Remember, everything in the kingdom functions by exchange. You give God your fear, he gives you his boldness. You give him your sinful life, he gives you his righteousness. So the next time you give God your fear, your worry, and ask him to hand you back some divine expectation that something good is going to happen to you. I want to talk about employing the prophetic. There's a story in Numbers 10:29. Now Moses said to Jethro, his father-in-law, the Midianite, we are setting out for the land of which the Lord said, I will give this place to you. Come with us and we will treat you well, because we got a word from the Lord, a prophetic word, that he's going to give us the promised land. It's going to be good things for Israel. And Jethro said to Moses, I will not go with you. I'm going to leave you and I'm going to go to my own relatives. So Moses went back and he made an appeal. Please do not leave us, inasmuch as you know, we are to camp in the wilderness. We've never been there before. And you will be eyes to us. That's the name of the message. Now, why would he say that? Well, he knew that Jethro, a high priest of the Midianites, was a prophet. He was not only a high priest, he was a prophet. And the Midianites were known as expert trackers. Matter of fact, they were fabled by people who said, these people have such discernment, they move in the Holy Ghost so much that they can even see in the dark. Well, that's a spiritual truth because they had light, prophetic light, where they could see things that other people could not see. And the prophetic anointing has been given to each of us and the church, because we are all the church together, that the prophetic gift is literally eyes to us, the ability to see what the natural cannot see. The prophetic is a seeing gift to understand, and not only understand, but again to obey by knowing what to do. Now, it's kind of interesting to understand how this happened. And for some of you watching out there, maybe you don't have the fullness of the gospel yet. Abraham was married to Sarah, and Sarah eventually died, and he had a second wife named Keturah. And they had three children, and a third son was a guy named Midian. And Midian grew up, and he went out, and he built a city called Midian, and everybody in the city became Midianites. And what's interesting about them is Midian, of course, was the seed of Abraham, and the Midianites were different from everybody else. The Jewish people and the Midianites were different from everybody else because everybody else worshiped multi-gods, poly-gods, but the Midianites still worshiped the one true God. And what's interesting about that, when you go down, that that was Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Joseph. And then remember the brothers, because he was a prophetic gift, they dug a hole and threw him in the hole. And it was the Midianites who happened to be coming by that got him out the hole, or he would have died in the hole. So God sent some deliverers that were of the seed of Abraham. They just happened to be going out in the desert and they see this boy. Okay. So we go to Joseph. Joseph was at a time in bondage, and all of the people were 400 years locked up there, and they cried out for a deliverer. So God raises up a little baby who grows up to be named Moses. So Moses did what most of us did. He didn't listen to spirit as a deliverer. He did what he thought he should do, so he kills an Egyptian. When he kills the Egyptian, he realizes what he did, and he flees, and he winds up in a town called Midian. And Midian had a high priest named, that was a prophet, named Jethro. And Jethro had a good-looking girl, daughter, that they got married. And so then God was still promising the land. And Moses was delivered by the Midianites. And then he wanted Jethro to guide them in a place that he was not going. Jethro, of course, represents the Holy Spirit, the enlightenment, the eyes in the Spirit that reveals truth to us. Now, I said that for those of you watching out there. And what I want to tell you is that before you even made the worst mistake you ever made in your life, like Moses, God had already planned a deliverance for you. I want you to know that before there was a world, the Lamb was already slain. And I want you to stop thinking about the worst mistake you ever made. I don't care how dark it is. God has already prepared a deliverance, and His name is Jesus Christ. And I pray today at the end of this, we're going to say a prayer for you to commit yourself to God, to understand you never have to think about that again, because it's already blood washed. And God forgives you, and He wants you to begin to have eyes to know that he's alive and well, and your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. Since we don't live in church 24/7, we're not always in a church service. What does that mean? You always don't have Brother Mike or somebody else. You have to learn, like I do, to ask the Holy Spirit to be eyes to you in your personal walk. Because you got to make decisions all the time. You constantly, if you're going to walk forward, you're always going to have to be, and you want to be Spirit-led. You don't want to always be wasting your prayer for God to get you out of something. You want to just be walking in Spirit where there's life and peace. So we should be stirring up the gifts of the Holy Spirit, praying in the Spirit, and expecting prophetic mysteries to be revealed. See, 1 Corinthians 14, 1-2, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you prophesy. There's a whole bunch of people that you're connected to that whether to receive it or not, you're assigned to them. And you would have a prophetic word, not just for you, but for their life too, unless you don't feel like you have that. Well, you got to stir it up till that passion comes and the Holy Spirit moves upon you because you have a valuable place for many, many other people, including your generations. For it says, for he who speaks in tongues in the Spirit speaks mysteries. You know, it's an amazing thing. You can speak in tongues and you can be doubting at the same time because your mind is always activated. You can be worried about something while you speak in tongues. What you need to do is realize, while I'm speaking in tongues, I'm speaking to God in mystery and a prophetic word. And remember, miracles follow the prophetic. So activate the prophetic word that you speak. What you need to do is pray in the Spirit until you're speaking in tongues so much, you get your own interpretation for you. And David encouraged himself in the Lord. I've done this many times. To overcome my worst of mine, I just speak in tongues and plead the blood. And all of a sudden that knowing comes. And that meditation on the word produces what prophecy is. I call it the inspired speech of prophecy. When I was in the hospital, I was inspired to speak those words. And I'm alive today because of it. I didn't come into agreement with what man said. I came into agreement with what God told me. It didn't change the way I felt in the moment. But the peace of God overcame my physical body and I got better. Our natural minds aren't able to handle God's truth. Our minds would rather lean on our familiar own understanding, on our reason and logic. We go to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Reason and logic. Proverbs 3:5 says, don't lean on that natural understanding. 1 Corinthians 2:13 through 14, these things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but with the Spirit teaches, the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. For the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can they be known because they are only spiritually discerned. I'm really disturbed by preachers I know that are interpreting what's going on, what the world is saying through the media, things they don't know anything about, and they are adding spiritual overtones to something where God never spoke to that. Now, if God speaks to you on what's going on, that's another thing. But you judge spiritual things with spiritual things and natural things with natural things. And if you're born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, you don't know anything but Jesus Christ. And you should not know anything but Christ and Christ crucified. And you go to the Word and you let the Word, and the Word's going to tell you, be anxious for nothing. The kingdom can't be shaken. Behold, I never leave you nor forsake you. Believe though, 1,000 fall at this side and that side, you're still going to be standing. So you have to not let the world woo you. You wait on a prophetic word of God and it will quiet your anxious mind. As Jesus' disciples were following him, he uses four methods to handle prophetic truth. Number one, parables. They asked him, why in the world did you do this? Well, we're the only ones that understand you. He said, that's why I do it. God doesn't want to waste anything on people who don't want to follow him. So in Mark 4, 30 through to 34, and many such parables spoke Jesus, his words to them as they were able to hear it. But without parables, he did not speak to them. But when he was alone with his disciples, he expounded deep truths. The Holy Spirit will tell you deep truths, but he might not tell your sister-in-law. He might not tell your best friend. He's speaking to you. He was going to expand it. So also there are representations. God uses something we easily do understand so we can draw a comparison to understand what he's trying to reveal to us. All right. When you talk about a mansion in heaven and golden streets, these are things that we understand we value in this life to try to understand how great God's going to be. Psalm 1:3, a righteous man is like a tree. He's a tree? Well, he has limbs, right? Okay. A righteous man is like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. His leaf will not wither, and whatsoever things he does shall prosper. God is trying to express something on prosperity. If we're planted where in the place that God plants us, where we're rooted in the things of God, we're planted and rooted in the Word of God. Now he talks about us, the people that are lazy. He says, consider the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. Again, God uses something we're familiar with to give us a spiritual truth. Then I like the fact that God talks in extremes. He talks about, I created everything. I spoke the stars. I even named every star and so on. And we're amazed that God keeps all these things and it keeps on expanding in every way, and he's got it all covered. And then he immediately goes to the other extreme. I know how many hairs are on your head, and in my case, on my lip. And he says, I even know when a sparrow falls. My God, God is showing the majesty of him. He can create everything, keep it all in control at the smallest detail he's aware of. And God uses situation. Now, I've been in this classroom way too long right here. What is, if you don't get it, if you don't get God's truth by revelation, by faith, and trusting with it, he's going to make sure you go back to class again. You're going to have the opportunity to learn it by situation. So if we don't get it, we're going to understand by personal experience until we do get it. And some of you about there, you already been in that class too. Proverbs 21:13, whoever shuts his ears at the cry of the poor, you don't get it? Well, then you're going to find out one day you're going to be crying and nobody came. How about the disciples feeding the 5,000 men and the women and the children with the fishes and the loaves? They get on the boat. And one of them says, did you bring the bread? And the other said, no, I forgot the bread. And they get all upset. And Jesus says, where were you when a couple of pieces of bread? Now you get on the boat and you're worried you're on the boat with me and you don't have any bread. You didn't get it? Well, okay, here comes the storm. The boat is rocking. And what happens? They see Jesus walking on the water in the storm. And they go, Jesus! You see, when they felt successful. They passing out everything and they picking it up. Man, we involved in this great miracle. But they didn't invite Jesus. Matter of fact, they doubted Jesus. How are we going to pay for this? How are we going to feed this many? But when the boat is rocking and in the storm, it's a good idea to invite him. And the lesson was, you can do nothing without me. But I'm going to pass you by unless you invite me. So I'm telling you out there, don't let your emotions and your imagination get you. You in a bad spot? Call out and tell him, man, my boat is rocking. I need a prophetic word. I need you to come in. I need you to come quiet my spirit. I want you to please know, though the scripture says they didn't get it because their hearts were hardened. In this case, and in your case, I want you to know, a hardened heart is not an evil heart. It's not a wicked heart. It's just a heart that doesn't have any light in it. It didn't have the truth. You got a mind and that has sealed off. It's done what it seems right. It thinks what's normal and natural. And that causes the heart to be hardened and you can't get a prophetic word. You want God to crush your heart. You want him to send light. You want to ask him. This lesson is all about navigating radical change in this uncertain season, and you do it by asking God to give you a prophetic word, either from an authorized prophet or from the spirit that lives in you, because you want to activate that anointing. Psalm 107:28, they cry out to the Lord in their time of trouble, and he delivers them out of the distresses. Man, get in the room, and instead of whining and crying and watching the television, start crying out for God to do something great in your life, no matter what goes on. Because knowing is seeing. 1 Corinthians 2:16, for who has known the mind of the Lord that we may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. It's really frustrating. Why don't we activate the mind of Christ? Why do we have to think for ourselves? Why is it we lean on our own understanding? And what's worse, why do we want to lean on somebody else's understanding? So we want to pray and believe for the eyes of our understanding to be opened. Indeed, instead of thinking, reasoning, and imagining how to react in times, in seasons of extreme change, we want to welcome the prophetic knowledge that's already in us. Ephesians 1:17-19, praying that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, I love this prayer, praying that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your, not your neighbor, the eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling for you, what is the riches of the inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according, not in heaven, the power that is already working in you, the precious Holy Spirit. Right now I pray for everyone listening to me, regardless of you understood a word that I said, I'm praying right now for all of our people, that you receive a word of prophetic prophecy, that God is going to plant in you a desire, an awakening for a prophetic word. And that prophetic word is literally going to open up the eyes of your spirit. Light will come. Hallelujah. The light of the Lord has risen upon you. The glory of God is going to come upon you. Instead of worrying about what's said on the television sets that are counting dead bodies, you're going to say, Lord, here am I. Speak to me, Lord. I'm your servant. Here am I, Lord. Use me. Reveal your truth. I'm here. Brother Dan, I want you right now, there are many people watching us, people in Europe, people all around the world that have been watching this teaching, and I want you to give them an opportunity to commit themselves.
Well, amen. The word of God has gone forth, and scripture teaches us that the word is living, it's powerful, and it discerns to the cry and the thought of the heart. So maybe you're out there, and I'm speaking to someone, maybe you're in a living room, wherever you are and however you're seeing this broadcast. Pastor Mike talked about an opportune time. Well, today is the day. Now is the time for our salvation. And the Holy Spirit heard the cry of your heart. And you say, like in the book of Acts, what must we do to be saved? And the Bible says, he who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. And Paul said that in the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses unto salvation. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If that's your heart's cry, I just want you to repeat this prayer wherever you are. Father, we acknowledge that we have sinned against you. And that, Father, we believe that you so loved us that you had a plan, that you allowed your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins, to be our substitution. Father, we believe it. We confess Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. We believe that he died on the cross. He rose from the dead. He ascended to the right hand of the Father, where he ever sits interceding on our behalf. We confess that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. Jesus, be not only our Savior, but be our Lord. So if you've prayed that today on behalf of White Dove Fellowship, We congratulate you. I know personally it's the greatest decision that I've ever made. And I want to ask you if you would to reach out to White Dove Fellowship if you've confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today. Let us know. Send us an email. Look us up on the website. Get a phone number. Call us. We would love to speak to you and pray with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us. This concludes our service.
Thank you for joining us for service today. Right now, I want to encourage you to stay in touch with us. You can go to our website and our contact field. You can put your name, email, and information in that. And we're going to be steadily putting out information, emails. We're going to be putting stuff out through YouTube. And so just periodically check with us. We want to keep everyone connected during this time. And we hope to see you here next week. Thank you.